morning.
Morning.
Happy Easter to everyone. Let's try this and see how you do. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
All right, that was pretty good. But now that everybody knows the response, when I say Christ is risen, if you would respond, Christ is risen indeed. Ready? Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Oh, that's good. Christ is indeed risen, and it is a joy to be here on this Easter Sunday gathered in worship. Welcome to those that are here and to those that are worshiping with us from home. I'm Jenny Day, the pastor at Dayton, and what a privilege it is to be here on this beautiful Sunday morning as we celebrate our risen Lord. A couple of things as we get started this morning. We will be celebrating Holy Communion today as it is Easter Sunday, and that seems an appropriate thing to do as we celebrate. And so a reminder, here we have a couple of ways if you want to experience communion. If you are more comfortable remaining in your seat during that time, we have individual elements in a package at the back of the sanctuary. If you didn't pick one up and would like to, feel free during the first hymn to go grab one. If you would prefer to come forward and receive, you can do that during the time, and I will give you a piece of bread, and Graham will have individual cups of grape juice for you. So whichever way you prefer is fine. And a reminder that in the United Methodist Church, all are welcome at the table. So please, if you feel comfortable, come forward and receive that. For those that are worshiping at home, I hope that you will have some juice and bread ready for that time together as well. Another note for this service, we now have ushers returning in our worship, which is a wonderful joy, and so thank you to the Geyer and Roadcap family for being our guinea pigs and our first ones to step up and do that this morning. So we will collect our offering during the worship service, like we used to do back in the old days, and we'll do that again. If you are interested in being an usher, we have a sign-up sheet on the table in what we call the narthex outside of the sanctuary doors. And please feel free to sign up for a Sunday. We would love to have you help out in that way. We in the United Methodist Church have different conferences that we belong to. And so we as Virginians belong to the Virginia United Methodist Annual Conference. But then we are all throughout the world under the umbrella of the General Conference, which is worldwide. And every 4 years, we have a conference called General Conference that gets together, and that's where any new updates are made to our Book of Discipline, our guidelines and ruling principles for the United Methodist Church. And we do have a General Conference coming up at the end of April and going into May. And so I ask you to pray for delegates. We have delegates from our annual conference that are voted on and are going, and delegates coming from throughout the world that will be gathering in Charlotte, North Carolina for that event. There's a lot of legislation that is up for discussion and voting, and the Virginia Conference has done a really good job of putting out different little videos about different things that are going to be brought before it. And so if you want more information or want to kind of know what's going on, there is a website in your bulletin insert or in the scrolling announcements. Please go check it out and see just, you know, all the things that we're talking about and what might be decided. And then after the General Conference, we'll have some discussions about what actually happened and was voted on. A couple of wonderful activities coming up. Our Young First Followers, our children's ministry, will have their April gathering on the 14th from 2 to 3:30. So any children in our congregation, or if you have grandchildren, or you know some families in your neighborhood with children, invite them to come and be a part of that. It's a wonderful time, and we are so blessed to have Betsy and Jessica leading us in that. And then for our youth, they have a big fundraiser coming up on the 19th. It's a trivia night in our here in our fellowship hall. And so hope you'll plan to come and be here for that. I know it was a lot of fun last year, and it'll be a lot of fun again this year. And that the money that is raised for that goes towards their mission trip. And speaking of the mission trip, the deadline to register for that is tomorrow, April 1st. So please, if you have youth that want to participate in that, please register for that. You can talk to our wonderful youth minister, Whitney, if you want more information on that. But it'll be a wonderful time and a time of growing and fellowship. Lots of other things going on, and so I hope that you will take this home and look it over, see where you might get engaged and connected in the life of the church, where you might want to serve and be in mission as well. At this time, will you stand in body or in spirit and join me in our call to worship? Out of the darkness of grief and despair comes a message of hope. Christ is risen. We run to the tomb to see for ourselves, and it is true, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
We hear a voice call our name, and we know our risen Lord is with us now and always. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Thanks be to God.
Will you join me in singing hymn number 302, Christ the Lord is risen today? And since we only sing it once a year, we will sing all the verses.
Thank you.
As we come to a time of prayer this morning, is there anything that you wish to share before one another? Yes, Robin. Okay, all right. So prayers for Joe Helsing, who was taken to the hospital this morning. He has Parkinson's and has been falling a lot recently and fell. This morning has some weak legs, so prayers for Joe, for Mona, for Robin, absolutely. Is there anyone else? Well, let us go to God in a word of prayer. Almighty and loving God, how grateful we are to gather this morning in worship to celebrate you and your goodness. God, your faithfulness lasts for generations, and we are so thankful. You have blessed us beyond measure, and far too often we take credit for ourselves when really all honor and praise should go to you. God, for all good things come from you. You have blessed us with family and friends and this church home. You have blessed us with new life and the beauty of creation that we see these days. Even when our allergies flare, still it is a great reminder that new life is just around the corner. We thank you for the promises of spring, for the flowers that are blooming and the trees that are budding. We thank you for this day to come, this holiest of days, to remember that though we have been through a long and painful week with ups and downs, we return to celebrate the risen Lord, that death could not hold him, that he conquered the grave, not just for his own sake, but for ours as well. And so, God, we come in praise, lifting our voices together in hallelujah, praising you for your goodness and your mercy, for all the joys and the celebrations of life, for birthdays and anniversaries, for time to visit with loved ones. For all that we have received, we thank you. And even though we come in this great celebration and this great and beautiful day, we know that there is also hurt and pain in our world, maybe even in our own lives. And so as we come before you, we come praying for those that are hurting, for those that are in need of your healing, for Joe and for all those that are on our prayer list, for all those that are facing or recovering from surgeries, for those that are battling illnesses and allergies, colds and flus, for those that are battling long-term illness like heart disease and cancer, for those that are struggling against mental illness, we lift them to your care. God, we pray for communities and countries that have been torn apart by violence. We pray that you would bring healing, that war would come to an end and peace would be found. We pray for people and places that have been impacted by natural disasters and human-made disasters, that you would be with them as they move forward and heal. God, we pray for the men and women who serve in our armed forces and all of our public servants, for those that put their lives on the line. We pray for your protection. We pray, God, for anyone that is traveling for this holiday or for the break from school and work, that you would keep them safe and in your care. God, for all of the things spoken out loud, for those written in our prayer list and for those written in our hearts, we turn them over to you now in the name of your Son, as together we lift the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite any children that are with us to come forward. And for the children worshiping with us from home, I hope you'll listen a little closer as we share a time together.
Good morning. Look at those Easter bunnies and carrots. I love it. Good morning and happy Easter, everyone. It's good to see you this morning. So this morning I have a basket filled with something that I bet is familiar to you all. Does the Easter bunny visit your house? Yeah. He came to my house this morning. I haven't gotten to check out my basket yet, but I saw it was there. So that's exciting. And does he hide eggs for you, these nice colorful plastic eggs to find? Yeah. Oh, maybe he's coming later. Sometimes he has to spread it out a little bit. You know, he has a lot of houses to cover. But if you ever have been to like an Easter egg hunt and gotten these eggs and stuff, it's fun because they have like candy in them, right? And we enjoy getting them. Oh, you did have an Easter egg hunt. Awesome. And was there candy in them? Yeah? All right. Well, do you know why we have Easter egg hunts and why we use eggs on Easter morning? Does anybody know? Well, think about when a chicken lays an egg, or I have a bird making a nest actually on my porch behind the light on my front porch, and she hasn't laid her eggs yet, but they're coming because I saw her and she's getting very, very big and she is ready to put some eggs in that nest. And then she'll sit on them for a little while, and then what happens? They hatch, right? And what comes out of the hatched egg? Little chicks, right? A new life, new creation. And so we use eggs to remind us that because Jesus died and because Jesus rose again, we too get to have new life, eternal life with God because of Jesus. And so we use those eggs to remember that, to remind us that there's new life. And that's, you know, no coincidence that we have Easter during spring. That's part of why it happened then, because we see signs of new life everywhere. Trees that look dead in winter are now budding again, right? And flowers that were down in the ground from last year are coming back up. And so these are all signs of new life to remind us that we have new life too. And so I'm going to send you home with an egg or two. You can take two because I have enough. But anytime that you see eggs and anytime you see these nice, wonderful, bright, colorful eggs, remember that Jesus loves you and that Jesus offers new life for you and for everybody. And we should be telling everybody that good news. Sound good? Do you want to pick two eggs to take with you? Good choices, the orange ones. You're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Will our ushers come forward? Every time that we come to worship, we have the wonderful opportunity and privilege to give out of what God has given to us. It's a joy to be able to share out of this, and so let us give with generous hearts.
Thank you.
remain standing and join me as we dedicate this offering. God of great gifts, this morning we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you thanks. With resurrection humming in our hearts, our minds are tuned to your song of peace. We joyfully present these gifts to you, a tangible chorus of thanksgiving, a harmony of hope for your kingdom come. Amen. Will you remain standing as you're able, and let's join together in singing hymn number 322, Up From the Grave He Arose.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Let's do it one more time. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. That's wonderful. Thank you guys for doing that again. If you would, join me for the prayer of illumination that you'll find in your bulletin or on the screen. Almighty God, through your only Son, you overcame death and opened to us the light of eternity. Enlighten our minds and kindle our hearts with the presence of your Spirit, that we may hear your words and comfort and challenge in the reading of the Scriptures. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture today is a small excerpt from Isaiah 53, verse 10. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. And our scripture for the sermon today will be John 20, verses 1 through 18, and this is the beginning of the Easter story, the Resurrection Sunday. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. And so she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and she said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." And so Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And he bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. And then Simon Peter, he came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. That cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, he also went inside. He saw and he believed, but they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. And then the disciples went back to where they were staying. And Mary, she stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been. One was at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" She said, "They have taken my Lord away and I don't know where they have put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that this was Jesus. But he asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Now she was thinking this was the gardener. She said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me, where have you put him, and I will go get him." And Jesus said to her one word, "Mary." And she turned to him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And so Mary Magdalene, she went to the disciples with this news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that the things that he had said to her. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please enjoy this anthem titled, "Love Brought Me Back."
Thank you.
I'll go ahead and just not give the sermon now. What more do we need, right? Okay, I guess since I prepared for it, I'll just go ahead and give it to you. For centuries in Catholic, Orthodox, and Protestant countries, Easter, Easter Monday, and Bright Sunday, which is the Sunday after Easter, many would observe faithful days as days of joy and laughter. They would have parties and picnics to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. Parishioners and pastors would play practical jokes on each other. They would drench each other with water. They would sing and they would dance. It was a time for Christians to tell jokes and to have fun. It's rooted in the musings of early church theologians that God played a wonderful practical joke on the devil by raising Jesus from the dead. The Easter laugh, they call it. While in keeping in the practice of this Easter laugh, it has been my custom to start my Easter sermons with jokes. And so today I'll begin the message in this same tradition. There was once a little girl who was home alone and ill. She called her mom at work and told her, "Mama, I need you really bad." Well, the mother took off frantically, rushed to the corner drugstore to bring home some medicine. She noticed it was beginning to rain, but she thought, "Oh, well, I'm just going to pop in and out to get the medicine for her sick little girl." So she didn't bring an umbrella or worry about that. When she got back to her car, she noticed something. You guessed it. She had locked her keys in the car. She ran inside to get help from the employees, but none of them seemed to know what to do to help her. And so finally, they gave her a clothes hanger and said, "Good luck." She ran back to her car, desperately trying to get the door open. The more she tried and the longer she tried, the harder it began to rain. Finally, out of desperation, she called, "Lord, I need your help and I need it right now." Immediately, an old pickup truck pulled up right next to her. She looked up and saw a man approaching her. He was dirty, had a do-rag on top of his head, and scars and tattoos all over his body. Without thinking, she embraced this man and said, "Sir, could you possibly help me? My daughter is sick at home, and I have to get this medicine to her as soon as possible, but I've locked my keys in the car." Within a minute or two, this man had successfully unlocked her car. Out of joy, she grabbed the man again and gave him another big hug. She said, "You're such a nice man." The man pushed her away and said, "No, ma'am, I'm not. You see, I have just escaped from prison and I steal cars for a living." Without any hesitation, this woman looked up to heaven and said, "Thank you, God, for sending me a professional." The pastor's family was invited to Easter dinner at the Wilson home. Now, Mrs. Wilson was widely known for her amazing contributions to the church potlucks. Everyone was seated around the table and as the food was being prepared, or as it was being served. As usual, it was a feast for the eyes, the nose, and the palate. When the pastor's youngest son, Peter, received his plate, he started eating straight away. "Peter, wait until we say grace," insisted his embarrassed mother. "I don't have to," replied the five-year-old. "Of course you do, Peter," his mother insisted rather forcefully. "We always say a prayer before eating at our house." "That's our house," Peter explained. "But this is Mrs. Wilson's house, and I don't have to worry because she knows how to cook." After dying in a car crash, three friends go to heaven for orientation, and they were all asked the same question. When you are in a casket and family and friends are mourning over you, what would you like to hear them say about you? The first guy immediately responds, "I would like to hear them say that I was one of the greatest doctors of my time and a great man." The second guy said, "I would like to hear them say I was a wonderful husband and school teacher who made a huge difference in our children of tomorrow." The last guy thought for a minute and replied, I'd like them to say, "Look, he's moving." Finally, an 80-year-old woman was recently married to her fourth husband. A reporter questioned the occupation of her newly acquired husband. She replied that he owned a funeral home. Curious about the other husbands, the reporter asked about their occupations. The woman paused and then stated that her first husband was a banker. The second she was madly in love with, and he was a circus master. The third was a minister. Puzzled by her answers, the reporter said, "None of these people have anything in common. Why did you marry them?" She stated that she married number one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go. Of all the wonderful jokes that are out there, the best one is the one that God played on the devil. Jesus was dead, and the adversary thought that he had won. But the joke was on him, because on that first Easter morning, God raised Jesus from the dead. And not only that, but God crushed humanity's death as well. That's what today is all about. Easter, the day that millions of Christians around the world gather to celebrate Jesus, who hung on a cross but has come down, who was in a tomb with a lifeless body, but which now stands empty. Sin, which once held us captive, has been defeated by God's grace and forgiveness. Throughout this last Lent, we shared in a series called Against All Odds, based on Isaiah chapter 53 and the prophecies that Isaiah made about the coming Messiah. Let's take a brief minute to recap what we learned. The prophet Isaiah recorded his predictions 700 years before Jesus was even born. Isaiah 53 describes 24 actions that would be experienced by the Messiah, and they were all fulfilled in Jesus. Among them are things like the Messiah would be despised, rejected, and betrayed, that he would be silent when facing his accusers, that he would bear our sorrows and our sins, and by bearing our sins, he would heal our sickness from them, that he would pay for our wrongdoings. Isaiah predicted that he would be successful, which is really an understatement if you consider who Jesus was and is. And Isaiah predicted that Jesus would be raised from the dead. The reason we've called this series Against All Odds is because several years ago, a mathematician named Dr. Peter Stoner did some work with probability theory. He sat down and determined the odds for any one person fulfilling only 8 prophecies in Scripture. Stoner's calculations showed the probability of fulfilling 8 prophecies was so minuscule, it would be impossible. Stoner said the chance that any human might have lived down to the present time and fulfilled 8 prophecies is 1 in 10 to the 17th. That's a 1 with 17 zeros behind it. And it's called 100 quintillion. So what are the odds that anyone could fulfill 48 prophecies of Scripture? The number is so big that we don't even have a name for it. Yet in his life, Jesus not only fulfilled 48 prophecies, or he fulfilled those 48 prophecies in his death, but in his life he fulfilled 332. What are the odds? Impossible. And yet he did. But of all the prophecies, the greatest is this: Jesus' resurrection from the dead. What are the odds that a dead person would come back from the grave? Well, it has been done a few times, mostly involving an emergency room or an operating table or being trapped in icy water and being revived afterwards. It happens, but not often. And yet Jesus wasn't revived. He was resurrected. What are the odds that someone who had been crucified and pronounced dead by a professional Roman executioner, who had had his body pierced with a spear, who had had nails drilled into his hands and feet and held to a cross, who was wrapped in 200 pounds of spices, including his mouth and nose, who laid behind a 2,000-pound stone, could revive himself, move the stone, walk 14 miles that very afternoon, and convince his friends that he was completely restored to health. The odds are zero. Jesus' resurrection was a miracle against the odds, and it was predicted in Isaiah 53. In verses 10 through 11, it describes Messiah's death and resurrection as part of God's will. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with affliction. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. The verb in Hebrew for the word prolong is orek, which means long or extended. But there are places in the Bible where this same word refers to an everlasting, resurrected afterlife. And this is exactly what's being used in Isaiah chapter 53. The Easter resurrection of the Messiah predicted 700 years before it happened. What are the odds? We make a big deal about Easter because it is a big deal. This is the day on which everything hinges. This is the day that our entire faith rises to the mountaintop, the day in which it all matters, because there is transforming power in Jesus' death and resurrection. Before Jesus' resurrection, the cross was known as an instrument of excruciating death and punishment. It was reserved for the worst criminals and enemies of the Roman Empire. But today, because of Jesus' resurrections, many Christians wear a replica of the cross as a piece of jewelry. I'm wearing them in my ears. Or they have it on a tattoo, or we have ornate crosses in the sanctuary. What was once an ugly icon of death has now become a thing of beauty. For all around the world, the cross is seen as a symbol of hope and a reminder of God's love for all people. Before the resurrection, the grave was looked upon as a final chapter, the closing of a door, the end of everything. But because of Jesus' resurrection, we can rejoice that death is now only a new beginning, life eternal with God. We spend so much time and effort on things of this world, but that's not where true richness is found. The writer and movie star Dale Evans once said, "I spent most of my life searching for the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Then I finally found it at the foot of the cross." Henry Garrity's book, Portraits of Perseverance, tells the story of a man named Carl. He was an extremely wealthy man who owned a great estate. And one of his favorite pastimes was riding horseback throughout the valley, looking at everything he owned and congratulating himself on his great wealth. One day, as Carl was riding along, he came up over a hill, and in the distance he saw one of his tenant farmers, an old man named Hans. It was lunchtime, and Hans had set a little table under the shade of a tree and was now ready to eat. But before he ate, he bowed his head, folded his hands in prayer, to thank God for the food. Carl watched the old man as he prayed, and then he looked at his meal. It was only a slice of coarse bread and a small piece of cheese. With a sneer, Carl said, "If that's all I had to eat, I wouldn't bother to pray." Hans replied humbly, "It's enough, and I'm thankful God has provided it." Taken aback by the old man's answer, Carl turned his horse and prepared to ride away. But before he could leave, old Hans said, "Wait a minute, I need to tell you something. I had a dream last night, and in my dream I saw a beautiful scene, and I heard a voice saying, 'Tonight the richest man in the valley is going to die.'" "Poppycock," said Carl as he rode off toward home. But as he was riding, those words of old Hans haunted him. "Tonight, the richest man in the valley will die." Up to then, he had felt quite well, but now he was beginning to experience pains in his chest, and he wondered, could it possibly be true? Am I going to die tonight? When he reached home, he called his doctor and told him of old Hans's dreams and the pains that he had been feeling. And the doctor says, well, it doesn't sound like you have anything you ought to be concerned about, but just to put your mind at ease, I'll come over and examine you. So the doctor did, and after the examination was over, he said, Carl, you're as strong as a horse. There is no way you are going to die tonight. Carl said, well, I feel mighty foolish that I paid attention to the old man's dream about the richest man in the valley dying tonight, but just wanted to be certain. Reassured, Carl went to bed. The next morning, there was a knock on his door, and the messenger said, Carl, old Hans died last night. In that moment, Carl realized that truly, the richest man in the valley had indeed died that night. Before the resurrection, death was the end. But after, now we have the hope, because Jesus Christ is alive. We have the promise of Scripture that our sins are forgiven by his blood shed. We have the promise of everlasting life because his broken body. When we repent of our sins and turn our lives to God, then that promise of new life is for us as well. Because the greatest transformation of the cross is you and me. 2 Corinthians tells us, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything is made new. All of this from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, not counting our trespasses against us, but for our sake made him be sin who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. What is that good and transforming news of the cross and resurrection? When we bring our sins before the cross, they are wiped clean. We are transformed. Everything old has passed away, and everything new has come. That is the power of the Messiah, that against all the odds, he conquered death. Not just his death, but our death as well. And that, my friends, is no joke. Hallelujah. Amen. Will you stand now in body or in spirit and join me in our next hymn, Christ is Alive, number 318.
Thank you.
body was broken and his blood was poured out, but that was not the end. For we know what happened on that Easter morning. His body was made whole again so that we too could be made whole. We remember this every time we come to the communion table as he instructed us to do. And so the morning we come in thanksgiving and in praise and in remembrance of God's mighty acts in Jesus. Christ our Lord invites to the table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God,
we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach the good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to God, broke the bread, and said, "This is my body. As often as you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took a cup, again gave thanks, gave it to the disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of God's mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we come to offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and worshiping at home. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry in all the world, until Christ comes in final victory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Creator, now and forever.
Amen.
The body of Christ broken in his love for us. His blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins. For those that are remaining in your seats to receive communion, and for those worshiping with us online, I invite you to receive now the body and the blood of Christ. For those that wish to come forward, if you would just follow those in front of you and come to receive. The table is set. Won't you come?
Thank you.
Will you join me in the prayer after receiving? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery, in
which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Will you stand once more and join me in singing, Thine Be the Glory?
Jesus.
risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Oh, that was a good one to go on. As we go, let us remember that Christ is risen. And let us remember what that means for all of us. Let us go sharing the good news of Easter morning. The tomb is empty. Christ is alive, and we are alive in him. As you go, may the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen.
Going to eat lunch with him.